everyone for coming back. So, some very quick announcements. Those of you that on a first come, first serve basis already got confirmation about the DESI tour today, you have already received the email also today. We will meet outside at 11:15 to walk there, to walk to the starting point of the DESI tour. Apart from those people, also many of you expressed interest here at our secretaries, and she took note of your names. And for this we created a second group. So whoever have already, not anyone else, but whoever have already left their names at the secretary can join also the tour. So please also gather at 11:15, right after the end of the lecture, and follow our student here at DESI, Niklas Henkev. You can raise your hand and okay, you see him. And follow him to where the DESI tour will start. For those who cannot make it to the DESI tour, don't worry. Right after Claude's lecture, we will have a host of suggestions for new things to try in our history afternoon. Okay. That's as far as announcements go. And now, it's a pleasure for me to welcome Claude Cook. He is, as of recently, a permanent member at CERN, staff member at CERN. And he will introduce to us the fifth topic of our school, which is the mathematical structure of thermodynamics. Welcome, Claude.
Thank you, Jonas. So yeah, indeed, the topic of the lecture is mathematical. So the topic of the lecture is the mathematical structure of finite. And, well, I guess you've seen in previous lectures by David and also a little bit by Johannes that the way we compute solvable to quantum field theories usually through the topic of expansion, because we don't know how to compute amplitudes or correlation functions exactly. And if you work into topic of quantum field theory, you go to higher orders, you naturally end up with integrals over the momenta that flow in the loops. So when you do the expansion, every order you have a loop, you always do the expansion number of loops, and you have to integrate over momenta that flow in the loop. And then what you get is integrals of the following type. So these integrals are called Feynman integrals. So just to set my notations, let me define precisely what I mean by this. So, a Feynman integral for me is an integral of the following type. Say I have L loops in my Feynman graph. For each loop I have a momentum flowing in the loop. And then I have a bunch of propagators. And let me always, for now at least, put explicitly the Feynman absolute description. I will explain all the symbols after I finish writing. So, the denominator is just a product of propagators, and in the numerator I have some polynomial, and in dot products either between two loop momenta or between a loop momentum and p, which are external momenta. So p's here are external momenta. And let's say I have e of them, and this satisfies momentum conservation. Or currently they have e minus one of them. the case of my loop momentum, d is the space-time dimension. And so the m's are the masses of the propagators, and my qi's, they always have for me the following form. So they are linear combinations of loop momenta and external momenta. I put E minus 1 because one of them I can always remove via momentum conservation. And for me, alpha and beta, they are minus 1, 0, or 1. Because if you do Feynman integral, the coefficients here are just plus minus 1 or 0. So that is the most general scalar Feynman integral I can consider. Scalar because you see everything here is a dot product. I don't have open Lorentz indices. That is not a restriction because I guess you very well know from the quantum field theory class that every tensor integral via tensor reduction can write as in a combination of scalar integrals. Okay, I'm not going there, we can discuss it maybe in the end of the lecture if you want, but for now I just tell you that scalar integrals is all you need. And so, well, if you have any questions, please interrupt me, okay? So, those are the integrals you want to study. Those are the integrals that you have to know how to compute if you do higher order computations. And I just realized I forgot to define one thing. The NIs, for me, are natural numbers. You could also put Z, but then it would be the numerator and it would be part of my numerator for the number. Okay, and so the content of these lectures is a little bit to understand what is the mathematics behind these objects and what are the kind of properties, but also what are the kind of functions, numbers, so on that come out of these guys, and how to manipulate and compute with these numbers and functions. Okay? Is the scope of the lecture clear? Okay, some very elementary properties, very easy. So, I guess one is comments or properties if you want. We already said all of these integrals, the way about the ground, since they're scalar, they are long invariants. And therefore, they are only function of dot products. Okay. The way they were written down, it looked like they really depended on individual momenta, but obviously by Lorentz invariants, you can only depend on dot products. The other thing that you probably know, it's more of a reminder, that the way you actually compute them is usually not, well, yes, this is written down in Minkowski space, but you prefer to compute these guys usually in Euclidean space. And the way you do that is that you replace the energy component the I times the energy component. Because then your Minkowski product goes into minus Euclidean product. Note that Rigor rotation is a bit more complicated than just this cooking recipe. It's really the continuation that takes into account where the poles are. We can also discuss that later, but I think most people have seen this at some point in their curriculum, so just to remind you that what you do is you do it. And the other comment, will actually be very important for the throughout the course publication, is that usually without a photo. So the way I've written them down, if you put D equals 4, which is the dimensional space time we live in, that thing that I wrote down is really fine. It's just literally most of the time. But most of the time. The things we go to compute most of the time. There are two types of divergences. There's UV divergences, and there are divergences. UV divergences, I guess you know, without your move by renormalization. There are divergences you cannot remove by renormalization. The divergences come from, say, the masses here are not there, and all of a sudden you have a loop momentum is very small, so in parallel, while V means the loop momentum is very large. That's approximation. Okay, I'm going very quick here because I assume that those are things that many of you have seen at some point in PP, but if you want me to spend more time on this, and so, relative divergent intervals. You need to regulate them. And the way we do that usually is using what's called dimensional regularization, which is, you can say, you consider the dimension to be arbitrary, close to 4. It could be some other integer number. And then you interpret your integral I. So my I now was a function of the I and dj and the dimension. And also this n, so we'll come back to that in a second. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to interpret my I, depending on the I, dj, the masses and the n's, or my scales, and the dimension. I will now interpret it as some Laurent series in FC. You can actually indeed prove that this function here, seen as a function of D, is a meromorphic function, always, with poles at most at positions where D is an integer, negative integer in practice. And so close to integer dimensions, this function of D has a Laurent expansion with at most poles. It's not an essential singularity, but with poles. Now, sometimes, well, people get afraid when they see, well, there is D has become not an integer, so how is it to be defined? There's nothing scary about it. It's just that the way it was done here, it looks a bit scary. But this thing is mathematically rigorous, and we'll come back to that in a second if you want. You can show that this thing can write in a different way, and this different way, it is literally function D, which when D is an integer and the integral converges, collapses to that. Okay, that is the way you should interpret the Imrec. Then the scary thing that you do integrals in non-integer dimensions is gone. It's really that you interpret that thing as being the value at D equals an integer of something which is a function of epsilon and is a meromorphic function. The other thing, which is conventional, but you will see why you do that in a second, is that in Dimrec, you conventionally change the integration measure to this. There's a reason why we do that. You will see that in a second. Where gamma E is what's called the Euler-Mascheroni constant. It's minus the derivative of the gamma function. We'll see why in a second. For now, it's connected. You see that this factor goes away as epsilon goes to zero, and this factor just gives one of pi squared, which kind of removes some volume integration or some spherical angle to that. Okay. Yes.
Sorry, integrals analytic in D, is that a result or a definition of integral?
Let's wait 10 minutes and so, and then we come back to that. Then you see what. It's that thing. Imagine, forget about this way to write. There's a function that you can write down that is manifestly an analytic function of E, which when that, it will also be an integral, when that integral converges, for D being an integer, it is equivalent to that integral of a method that I wrote down there. But the other integral will be defined for D in arbitrary complex numbers. But it's a homomorphic function in D. Okay, but you will see what that is in a second. Well, actually, let's do it right now before we then go together. It's maybe more complicated here. So that was one way of writing down the finite interval. As a form of I guess many of you have seen something called finite parameters. Who has never seen finite parameters? Okay, so let's take 1 over 8 times b. Okay? And what I will do is I will write it as, now I have to think. Delta of must be something like this. The number is correct. Maybe something like that. Maybe with some factor involved, okay, but. And now imagine you do that. So what I've done is I've taken 1 over product and I've written this as an integral from 0 to 1. And I can write it in a slightly more symmetric way, like this. That's the same, right? When I just put x2 equals to 1 minus x1 again. And so what I've done is that for each denominator, I have to introduce an integration constrained by some delta function, so that now my denominator, I have a single denominator. I can do the same. This day you can look at some textbooks. I don't have the formula here. When you have arbitrary powers, you will get a similar formula. And also when you have arbitrary denominators. But that means when you look up there, you can take your denominators and you place your denominators by an integral, one integral for each propagator of a single denominator. But each propagator is just a quadratic form. So you can just combine all of your things into one single big loop integral by completing squares, because each propagator is a quadratic form. And in the end, you get the loop integration is just one denominator, you integrate it out. But then you train it for the integrals of these edges, which are called finite parameters. Very quick because I assume that most people know this, but for those who don't know, that's a general idea. So you can trade your integral over propagators for an integral of finite parameters. And what you get is the following thing. So this factor is just this normalization factor, one for each loop. Where n here is just sum. Sorry, this was k. And u and f are polynomials in DXi. So now we come back to your question. Once you've shown that this holds, you can prove that this integral, E and D, has no role as dimensional space time anymore. You can show that that integral, if it converges, well, that integral in general becomes a neuromorphic function of D, with poles and poles and integral values of D. And when D is an integer and the integral converges, it's equal to that. Okay? So there's no mystery in this non-integral dimension. It's literally, that is, if you want, that's the condition of Feynman, of the differential regularity. There are other ways of representing integral up there called Schwinger parameterization. This is only called Feynman parameterization. Not going yet, just to tell you that there are different ways of writing these loop integrals. They all have their advantage. And they all make certain properties more manifest. In particular, they make often the mathematical structure more manifest. One side comment, you see that here. There are two things. One is you see that here, integration went up to 1, here goes up to infinity. Is it the same or is it not the same? The other thing is, it didn't tell you what the summation here is. And does it matter? We can discuss that in a discussion session some later. Be interested in the counter preview. The claim is it doesn't matter. What sum you put here doesn't matter as long as you put it in. Here you see, I could put infinity here because I have two variables that are positive and constrained to sum up to 1. I can also integrate up to infinity because they cannot get bigger than 1 anyhow. If I put here infinity, I could also just put x1 to 1 and forget about x2. And then go all the way to infinity. You can think about it.
So you see that the xi here are not Schwinger parameters, they are Feynman parameters, the way you define them.
Yeah, yeah, but then...
But you extend the integration range without any cost.
You can, if you, even if you do this, you define them like this, you can prove that you can change the summation here, as long as you put infinity here. It's something called, in the physics literature, I think it's something called the chain root theorem. And I'm asking to just simply to state me that this integral is a quadratic of it. This is actually an integral in projective space, and this delta function just fixes, it's one way of fixing like one of the coordinates. So in projective space, you could decide that, say, the first coordinate is 1 and all the others are 3, but you can also decide that they sum up to 1. It's just another way of fixing the gauge. Yeah?
Just to make sure that I understood it correctly. So each of these integrals, they are one of the terms in the Lorentz series.
No, this is the function C. This is the whole function B. If the integral converges, you can expand it in epsilon. In the integrand, you can expand the integrand. And then you get a representation of the IKs as integrals. But if the integral does not converge when D goes to 4, you cannot expand on the integration sign. Because you need to get poles in epsilon. And if you expand this integrand in epsilon, you would never get a pole, because if you expand the exponential, you just get a Taylor series. Okay? That is precisely where the problem is. The epsilon expansion and the integration do not commute. However, what you just said, there is some value in what you just said, which is that assume you could expand under the integral sign. So if, for example, I take an integral that is finite, I can expand under the integral sign. Then, what you see is, the kinds of integrals that you get are very special. They would only ever have polynomials and logarithms of those polynomials. They are not just random integrals. They're very special. And such integrals that are, well, essentially integrals of Lagrangian functions, they are also mathematically very special. The I epsilon there is, of course, an I zero. It's the small imaginary part, which is not the same as the space. Yes.
Is there
a
special
description
that you use?
Sorry?
For the other polynomial, is there
no description? No, because U, F, only kinematic dependence is in F. U is independent of kinematics, and it's positive definition. IK are, it's called periods. Of course, it doesn't tell you very much because you probably don't know what a period is. A period is you can think of it in your head as the integral of a Lagrangian function. I guess that is obvious from there, as long as the integral converges and epsilon is equal to 0. But you can show that it's always true. Actually, there's, if you're slightly more correct, then you add over domain specified by rational. That's the definition that goes back to Zagier and von Sickwich. What kind of numbers are periods? Yeah?
Pi.
Pi, yes. Why?
So you integrate all the circle.
Yeah. That is an integral of function 1 over the main specifier of the quality. All algebraic numbers like log 2, root 2, are periods. There you have to think a bit how that works. But you can show it. Log 2. Because log 2 is just that, huh? It's the integral of a rational function, 1 over x, between 1 and 2. Can you give me a number that is for the period? Yeah. It's expected not to be a period. The last time I checked, it was already a few years ago, 2-3 years ago, I think there were 4 or 5 numbers that were proven not to be periods. Are there more periods or more normal numbers? Huh? I mean, you basically have no examples of numbers that are not periods. So who thinks that most numbers are periods, since we don't have any examples of them? Most numbers we know are not periods. We don't know, most numbers we know are periods. There's a handful we can prove are not periods. Does it mean that most numbers are periods?
Most numbers are not periods.
Yes. Why?
Because most numbers cannot be written.
Sorry?
Most numbers cannot be written.
Why? Can you write down root 2? Can you write down why?
You can write it down as algebraic operations, but most numbers do not agree on this.
Yes, so the statement is that the number of rational functions is countable. Okay? The number of rational objects is countable. The total number of numbers is not countable. So the number of objects I can build in this way is countable. So it's kind of a paradox that we can prove that most numbers cannot be periods. They are really a measure zero set within all numbers. But the probability that if you take a number at random, that it is a period is zero, because you get a measure zero set. But if you have to construct a number that is not a period, it's very, very hard.
What about the limits of integration?
Sorry?
What about the limits of integration?
Everything there is rational, okay? When I say rational function, of course I mean rational function with rational coefficients, because as soon as you allow here arbitrary numbers, then of course you can build everything you like. Yes?
What is the rational?
It's an equality between, it's an equality between rational functions or polynomials. That is, for me, a rational equality. Okay? So, from this you see Feynman integrals are very special. You can only get very special things. In particular, there was a lot of effort in the last 5 to 10 years, also from the mathematical side. That's actually what I wanted to mention here. Periods are something that mathematicians are also very interested in. And it's actually, if you want to the theorem, that connection happens, that in number theory, mathematicians are interested in periods, and we know that Feynman integrals are concrete realizations of periods. And they are interesting ones, as we will see in the lecture. Any questions? Maybe some interesting property of periods, you know, this gave us that. So we said that all algebraic numbers, Q bar, are periods. Every period is a complex number. This, we said, is countable. This is obviously not countable. But OK. you also notice that this is a ring. This is a sampling of C with full field. So at least we expect them to be field. Things like 1 over pi, we expect not to be field. So you can multiply periods and you get back periods. You can add periods and get back periods. That is basically just because they're integrals, right? If you multiply integrals, you use Fermi's theorem and you get bigger integrals. Because of approximation. But if you invert an integral, well, that usually is not an integral. Or at least not natural. Yeah. So. Big chunk of the lectures will be about the kinds of theories that show up, and the simplest kinds of theories that show up. This is what we will do tomorrow. Before we do that, I will discuss another aspect, which is related to, well, I erase it now, that the integrals also functions of n. So we define these integrals also depending on these n, which are the powers of the polynomial. Okay. So what about the dependence on n? So, this is something that is in physics literature often called IVP relations. For the more mathematically inclined, this is the Ramco model for the Ramco's view. Simply because it took some kind of commodity theory for fundamentals. But it all boils down to the very fast. So what we will do is we look at our integral now as a function of the NR. And let me, for now, use, I defined it before as being n, but I can also choose z. Since z is numerator, making it, raising the denominator to a negative power is just the same as numerator. This gives me function on the lattice, which is zk. K is the number of denominators that I have. Okay? K. Number of polynomials. So what I get now is necessarily an infinite family of integrals. Bad integrals I have, and look at this function of this exponents. Again, you can say it's a function of this lattice, or equivalently, for every point of this lattice, I have an integral. It may diverge and it's exponentially regulated and so on, but at every point of this lattice sits an integral. So I have infinitely many integrals I could consider. Is, are they somehow related? So I have this lattice. So I have k equals 2, 2 propagators. I have this lattice now. And and every point of this lattice, they have an interval. Okay? This would be k equals 2. And let me write it down explicitly. So what is the family that I consider? So I consider it now as a function of these two denominators, these two variables. And say, for the sake of the example, I take one loop interval.
Did I make anything?
Yes. I assume that the mass of the block is a zero, just for simplicity. And so this is just the one loop two point function. Okay? P, here I have k, and I have raised the propagator to power ni. And here I would have k plus p raised to the power n2. Okay?
That is my.
And you see that at each point of this lattice sits such an interval. So are they all independent, or are they somehow related? Obviously, they are related.
That was all.
So, what is the naive way you can change the values of the propagator, the powers? If any naive operation that you can do to change the value of an exponent is to differentiate. Okay? If you take x to the n, you differentiate that with respect to x, you get x to the n minus 1. Up to something. So, the very naive operation I can do. So I can differentiate a propagator, say take k plus p squared to the power n2. When you differentiate that, I get n2. And well, if you do the computation squared, you get n2 plus 1. Okay? Times. Consistent, I should write it. Okay, so there's many operations to change the values of the exponent to this differentiation. So how can I build that into here? And I cannot just act with the derivative because k is the integration variable. The best I can do is I can ask, okay, what happens if I were to compute an integral of the derivative? So, the question is, what if I were to compute something like this? Of something, what do I find? Yeah?
Integral evaluated surface.
Yes. So what is it?
Depending on dimension zero.
Yes. What?
I mean, if you pick the dimension low enough, then the power of the dimension is low enough such that.
Yeah, but we want a dimensional realization, right? This thing is a function of the 4 minus 2 epsilon.
In Yeah, that you can continue with them.
You're correct. The answer is you get zero. And on the other side, what you get is you pull the integral inside, you get a sum of integrals. With different NRs. So in the end, what you've built is you've built relations between different points on this lattice. So we'll see the example here in a second. And that's first, the first part that we still need to check is that here actually you find, as your colleague said, he actually finds it. Surface term always vanishes in dimensional organization. In dimensional organization, integrals of total derivatives vanish. There's, well, I can give you a sketch of a proof. If you want an analytic one, then this would, your colleague just said, you show that it works somewhere and then you continue, but there's an algebraic way of coming to the same conclusion. Imagine you have this integral. And all the integrals that you consider are norms invariant. So, this integral is the same as this. Yeah. Now, imagine P is infinitesimally small, and this is the same as conclude is that 0 equals phi mu, yes, correctly. I leave it here as an exercise that this implies the total bit of this vanish. See, this is not yet a total derivative, okay? Because it's a total derivative if P is dependent of K, but if P is dependent of K, it's a total derivative. I need to do an exercise to show that one thing first here. Proportional to p squared. So if you want, call this epsilon times p, this would be epsilon squared. This term cancels. Yeah. Now divide by epsilon, and epsilon to zero. These terms would be on epsilon, they bend in the limit, and the term that is left is the first one.
Yes, I guess the only thing that needs to be discussed is the dot product of pm. But okay, Pm is general, P mu is general enough, I guess you can.
Yeah, so this must be valid for all. For all.
Yeah.
And you can do the same even for distance translations. You do the same with Lorentz generators. And, but it's basically saying what forces the integral to vanish is the fact that you require that the other one is vanished.
This line is what?
Sorry?
Is using what?
This is translation invariant, if you want, of f. The integrand is Lorentz invariant.
Okay, so this is, works in dimensional realization.
No, this works always. I'm just saying that whatever my integral does, it changes variables from k to k plus p. That's all it does. The integral doesn't change.
The question is then how is dimeric relevant? Because this seems to call independent of whether you have regularized or not.
Was yeah, because the integral itself may be divergent. I mean, if you're not in dimeric, that thing itself may already be defined. What time is it?
10 minutes.
Okay, that's good. Should be enough to get. Okay, so let's start from here, and now let's see what happens if we apply that to our integral, which is there. Put this up. Let's put this down. Let's apply it to that integral over there. So, okay, so what I will do now is I will go and but the first thing you can say is I can distinguish what? Let's say this. So, okay, yeah, we apply it here. The first thing I will do is I will consider regions where, so Ni, N1, N2, as for example, they can be both positive. One of them is positive, the other one is negative. One is positive, one is negative. My first one is 0. The first one is 0, the second one is positive. First one is, by both of them are 0. 0 minus. Minus plus. Minus 0. Minus minus. And that's one of these guys. I guess the other thing you can easily see is that the graph has a symmetry. Okay, so N1, N2 is actually the same as N2, N1. I guess that's also easy to see. You can also see that explicitly identical, you just change variables from k to k to minus k minus k. So that also tells you that these two cases will be the same. These two will be the same. And these two will be the same. Okay, only need to consider one half of the cases. Okay. Now. For now, let's work here. But let's start with the other. There's one other theorem that we will need. I will just give it to you. We can discuss why that happens in the discussion session of tomorrow. Right? Scaleless integrals have. So whenever there is no scale in my integral, in the natural iteration, that thing is zero. It's a literal zero. whatever other thing you think it could possibly be, it starts with zero. So let's look then, for example, at this region where n1 is positive and n2 is zero. Well, all those integrals look like this. Okay, because n2 is zero, so it's not there, just like a propagator. So that guy, I think you can see, is scalar. There's no p. P is the only scalar integral. So every integral of this type is zero. So all those guys are zero. And so is that. If you're here, all your integrals would look like this. If I expand this, you see that, oh, there is a p, but the dependence in p is essentially polynomial, and I can pull it out. So I get a combination of integrals that are all scalars, so they're all zero. So also these integrals are all zero. Also these integrals are all zero. And I guess it doesn't take a lot of convincing that all of these guys are zero. So there's only one non-trivial case, which is that case that we need to consider. Why did I tell you that? Well, because if I now go back to my lattice, it tells me something very cute about the lattice. It tells me that everywhere here, the integral is zero. So the only non zero integrals live in this quadrant. Okay? So let's look at the remaining case, the plus plus. Plus, I can write down 0 equals the integral, some derivative, because total derivatives vanish. Then I want the Norman scalar, so I have to put some vector multiplying the integrand here. So in brackets, I just put this over. And V, well, what can V be? V, the only choices I have is K mu or P mu, because these are the only vectors I have in K. And I'll let you work this out. And if you make these two, if you go through these two cases, V, P and K, you get the following relations. And the other one, I don't give it because time is running out. You can write down more, but it's also a relation of this type. The important point is that if you take this, you can rearrange terms to get to the following thing. So you get that, right, n1, n2 is equal to n1 plus n2 minus 1 minus d divided by p squared n2 minus 1. I n1 and 2 minus 1. Plus 1 over p squared I and 1 minus 1 and 2. And the same relation for n1 and n2 interchange. Yes. So what does this tell me? So imagine I sit here. This tells me that as long as my n's are not 1, because then I have a problem, I can replace this integral by an integral where I lowered n2, that's this term here, and an integral where I lowered n1. Okay? So I find that the integral that lives here is just the sum of these two integrals. And now I go on, I get a recursion. That integral is actually the sum of that integral and that integral. And I guess you see how it goes. This integral is this plus that. Here I'm now in the situation where I have a 1. If you go through it properly, I could not have written this equation when n2 is equal to 1. What would have happened, there's a term missing. It basically tells you that you cannot move further. But in any case, on here, everything is 0. But what you see is, you can, wherever you start from, you will be able to move down until you get to this point. Okay? Because I can always replace wherever I am, I can replace it by the two neighbors. Until I get to the boundary where I know my recursion stops because they're integral values. And also my recursion is singular. So the conclusion is that, since I'm up out of time, we'll discuss it a bit more tomorrow, that n1 and n2 is always proportional to 1, 1. And that is in fact a general fact. Can see this bit more tomorrow. It can take 15 minutes more to finish this. That if you look at these integrals as a partial n, you always find a finite number of integrals in there, such that any integral seen as a function of this lattice is just a linear combination of this finite number, which is called mass. And then in fact, if this number is finite, it's not trivial. That was only proven, I think, 10 years ago. Okay, let's discuss it more tomorrow.
Great, yeah, thanks, thanks a lot. And perhaps just one quick question, and Claude will be here this afternoon and also tomorrow. We have 3 lectures tomorrow, so we have plenty of time to expand. But one quick question, perhaps.
Can you say an example of a number that is not a
sorry?
Period? Because I didn't catch if you said an example of a number that is not a period.
A number? No. So there are some numbers that are proven to not be periods. I don't know them by heart. Okay. The ones that are expected not to be periods is the Euler gamma. E, the Euler number, 1 over pi.
Okay,
those are not expected to be periods, but there are not many that are proven not to be periods. Because you would have proved that there is no way to write it as an integral.
Yes, yes. This is why I
asked. Yeah, that's why it's very hard.
Okay, let's thank Claude one more time. Now in the next 5 to 10 minutes, our SAGE-X PhD student here at the Lorenzo Picavallo will give you some suggestions about